our first keynote speaker today is Richard Kaczynski from Yale University. Richard is the author of Perdurabo, The Life of Aleister Crowley, which is considered the definitive biography. He's also spoken internationally on the creation and cultural impact of the Thoth Tarot, and he maintains the Thoth Sightings webpage, which tracks appearances of the Thoth Tarot in popular media, including movies, television, graphic novels, and record covers. And today he's going to be talking, his talk is going to be Transmutation and Transmission of a New Iconography in the Thoth Tarot.
Thank you. I guess my first question is, can you hear me all right?
Yes.
All right. Well, good morning, and welcome to the Trans-States Conference. And I'd like to thank everyone, all of the organizers here for all of their work, and to Kaven especially. Awesome. For all of his work as well, and for giving me the opportunity to come out and speak to you today. So, in creating the Thoth Tarot between 1938 and 1943, author Aleister Crowley and artist Frieda Lady Harris updated and reinvented the classic imagery of the tarot in accord with the Western esoteric tradition and in terms appropriate for the modern age. In today's talk, I'd like to pay homage to the deck's underappreciated partner. Who was Frieda Harris? What did she bring to the table? What was her creative process? And how did she view the cards that she helped to create? I mean, let's face it, Aleister Crowley's interpretation of the Thoth Tarot, explained in head-spinning detail in his Book of Thoth, is readily available in various modern reprints. The deck's publication after the deaths of both his creators has been covered elsewhere, as has its subsequent influence on popular culture. Finally, Crowley's life story has been covered exhaustively and need not be belabored here. Very briefly then, Aleister Crowley was the sheltered only son of rich fundamentalists who, in the bloom of young adulthood, embraced everything that had been forbidden to him. Drinking, sex, poetry, and the occult. He was a member of the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn in the 2 years of its nadir. During his 1904 honeymoon, he channeled a revealed text, the Book of the Law, and devoted the rest of his life to exploring and promulgating its libertarian moral, philosophical, and mystical tenets, much to the dismay of the self-appointed watchdogs of social propriety who dubbed him the wickedest man in the world. Granted, he gave him plenty of ammunition by identifying with the great beast of Revelation, or to megatherion in Greek, though not so much as a satanic figure, but as the harbinger of a new dispensation of divine law. He headed two mystical societies, the AA, which he co-founded in 1907 as a successor to the Moribund Golden Dawn, and Ordo Templi Orientis, a German Masonic derivative which also taught sex magic and whose leadership he assumed in the 1920s. Crowley's imaginative writings frequently reference the tarot as a symbolic language, and his 1912 biannual journal, The Equinox, published for the first time anywhere the Golden Dawn's secret instructional paper on the tarot. Crowley's diary notes a pivotal dinner at the Royal Automobile Club on June 8, 1937. Writer Clifford Bax had invited Miam Stewart and Leslie Blanche to meet Aleister Crowley. At the last minute, they were joined by Lady Harris, an artist and spiritual seeker who, over the course of her life, would variously embrace the tenets of Christian Science, co-masonry, anthroposophy, thelema, Hinduism, and Gurdjieff's fourth way. Having recently read Uspensky's A New Model of the Universe, Harris had become very interested in tarot, but could find little information on it. This meeting prompted an ongoing conversation with Crowley in which, over the course of the next year, they agreed to collaborate on a new tarot deck. During this time, Harris also joined Crowley's magical orders. This letter indicates her having paid up to the Holy Royal Arch of Enoch, or the OTO fourth degree. However, she subsequently advanced as far as the seventh degree. So, Who is this Lady Harris? Margaret Frieda Bloxam was born in London in 1877. Her father, John Astley Bloxam, was a successful and respected surgeon, while Frieda's mother, Jessie Findlay Porter, was close friends with the Harrises. After a fire destroyed the London office of the Harris family business, Bing Harris and Company of New Zealand, Frieda and her sister helped young Percy Harris sort the surviving papers. Friendship and romance ensued. Frieda and Percy wed on April 2, 1901 at the Harris's home in Kingston. Percy Harris's 40 years in politics beginning in 1906 is well documented and includes serving as the chief liberal whip from 1935 to 1945. In 1932, he was created a baronet, thus making his wife Frieda Lady Harris. Now, I know that despite people referring to her for decades as Lady Frieda Harris, my understanding is that the wife of a baronet, in that case, the term lady appends to her surname, not her forename, making her thus Frieda Lady Harris. Percy Harris proudly proclaimed, "My wife is an artist and a good one. She takes her art seriously. In fact, works at her painting 7 days a week and generally 12 hours out of the 24. She has an immense output of pictures." Aside from her tarot artwork, however, few examples of this immense output are known to the general public. Her earliest published art includes 4 color illustrations for her book, Winchelsea, A Legend, dedicated to her mother who had died that April. A year or two later, she began disguising her paintings under the pseudonym of Jesus Chutney, in hopes of avoiding bias, pro or con, due to her title. Percy Harris recounts one incident from a Chelsea gallery show. "She was exhibiting a number of serious pictures, but she included a few that she had painted for a lark and signed them J. Chutney. One critic, after being very condescending about Frieda Harris's pictures, said he much preferred those by her young friend, Chutney." Jesus Chutney exhibited in 1929 at the New English Art Club, an alternative to the Royal Academy, but by 1932, art critic Paul Connedy, reporting on her show at the Wertheim Gallery in Burlington Gardens, revealed that Frieda Harris and Jesus Chutney were one and the same. The London Times declared her paintings to be original, generally pleasing in color, and most welcome when they deal with everyday material. Despite being outed, Harris continued to use the pseudonym, occupying a flat at 57 Petersham Road, Richmond, under the name J. Chutney, from 1934 to 1939. Here are 2 letters to Aleister Crowley that Harris playfully signed either as Jesus or J. Chutney. In April and May 1942, as Harris completed her work on the Thoth Tarot, the Leicester Gallery's exhibition Imaginative Art Since the War included among its 102 pieces her painting, Andrew Marvell's Garden, which the Times compared to the colored spirals and glass marble. Finally, one of her letters to Henry Holt indicates that the gallery Apollinaris displayed 90 of Harris's pieces in a November 1956 show. Details are sketchy concerning Harris's involvement in co-masonry, a variant of Freemasonry that admits women, but we know that she owned 2 Masonic aprons and a Masonic sash from Simpson and Company. She also produced these beautiful tracing boards or illustrations of Masonic initiation symbolism for the free craft degrees. These differ from her earlier style. Their surreal, angular images are more consistent with her work on the Thoth Tarot and are probably from the same period or later. Harris also did covers for some of Aleister Crowley's books. In late 1938, while beginning work on the tarot, she produced this Tree of Life dust wrapper for Little Essays Toward Truth. In the summer of 1941, she drew a sigil for the cover of his poem, Thumbs Up. In 1946, she provided a portrait of Crowley for the dust wrapper of Ola, an anthology of 60 years in song. And a year later, her work appeared on the cover and frontispiece of Crowley's funeral program, The Last Ritual. Finally, She supplied the cover art for a posthumous 1962 publication of Liber Aleph, the Book of Wisdom or Folly, which had been in press at the time of Crowley's death 15 years earlier. Far less is known about any of these than any of these are her original Christmas cards. These examples are from the late 1940s to early 1950s. After Percy Harris died in 1952, Harris befriended Indian dance sensation Ram Gopal. After she spent three years doing research and set design for Gopal's ballet, The Legend of the Taj Mahal, which debuted to rave reviews at the Edinburgh Festival on September 6, 1956. The Daily Telegraph called it more opulently staged and more vividly costumed than any such company seen before in Britain. And a two-week engagement at London's Royal Festival Hall immediately followed. Here is a program with a ticket stub for a closing night's performance. To my knowledge, the set pieces that Frida Harris so painstakingly designed have never been seen since those performances. So if you'll indulge me, I'd like this audience to be the first to see these for possibly the first time in 61 years. So here we have the Durbar Hall, a spring scene, a less festive Durbar Hall than the previous one, the Empress's boudoir, and the death chamber of Shah Jahan. Harris became so enamored with India that she found herself a guru and bought a 50% interest in a houseboat in Srinagar, Kashmir, where she lived out the rest of her years. She died on November 5th, 1962, and was buried in a Church of England cemetery there. Her family, discovering she had no grave marker, commissioned a headstone with a quote from Shakespeare's Cymbeline, "Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor the furious winter's rages." Okay, so let's now rewind to May 5th, 1938. Harris had just become Crowley's pupil, and for their collaboration, he loaned her a copy of his Equinox, containing the Golden Dawn's description of the arts of the cards of the tarot. They ambitiously allocated 6 months to doing 78 cards according to the descriptions therein. Since the essay did not describe the major arcana, they decided to follow the designs of medieval packs. Harris set to work, as demonstrated by early rejected drafts of the aces, which very closely follow the Golden Dawn descriptions. So for the Ace of Pentacles, we have, as the Golden Dawn described it, a white, radiant, angelic hand holding a branch of a rose tree, whereon is a large pentacle formed of five concentric circles. The innermost circle is white, charged with a red Greek cross. From this white center, 12 rays, also white, issue. These terminate at the circumference, marking the whole something like an astrological figure of the heavens. It is surmounted by a small circle, above which is a large white Maltese cross, and with two white wings. Similarly, for the Ace of Cups or Chalices, a white, radiant, angelic hand issuing from the clouds and supporting on the palm thereof a cup, resembling that of the Stolistes. From it rises a fountain of clear and glistening water, and sprays falling on all sides into clear, calm water below, in which grow lotuses and water lilies. The great letter of the Supernal Mother is traced in the spray of the fountain. Here are the other two aces, but in the interest of time, just please believe me when I say that Harris faithfully depicts all of their excruciating details. Harris also followed the descriptions of the court cards pretty closely, right down to the crab coming out of the cup. But she also executed these very creatively and distinctively. The Golden Dawn describes the kings, or knights, mounted on steeds. The princes are seated in chariots. The queens are seated upon thrones, and the princesses are standing firmly of themselves. With the exception of the Princess of Wands, they're on the right, or on the left, I should say, who is flying off with her drowsy Magi. The names appearing on the pips also follow the Golden Dawn titles pretty closely. the only exceptions, shaded here in blue, being where Crowley substituted a one-word synonym for a phrase. However, when Harris began to study the major arcana cards of the tarot decks at the British Library, she found them too dated and unsatisfactory to serve as models. Thus, she encouraged Crowley to design an entirely original pack, and that is where the real transmutation begins. There are several innovations in the reimagined Thoth tarot. I'll begin with the ones that we attribute mostly to Crowley. The Thoth tarot is the first deck to explicitly incorporate the Golden Dawn correspondences of color, Kabbalah, and astrology. But as Harris recounted, it went much farther than that. I could find very little information or research about the tarot until I met Aleister Crowley. He had studied the cards seriously for 40 years. I asked him to help me, and with great patience and courtesy, he did so. And we tottered along for 5 years, wrestling with the accumulated mass of tradition emanating from the sources, such as Freemasons, alchemists, Rosicrucians, Kabbalists, magicians, geometricians, gematricians, mathematicians, symbolists, diviners, numerologists, druids, spiritualists, psychologists, philologists, Buddhists, yogins, psychoanalysts, astrologers, and even heraldrists, all of whom have left traces on the symbols employed on the tarot. From these multitudes, we endeavored to reinstate the cards in their original sacred, simple forms, and, in addition, indicate the new Aeon of Horus, a terrifying apparition. As this last line tells us, Crowley's personal mythos is ubiquitous in the cards. For instance, lust depicts his interpretation of the great beast in Babylon from Revelation. The Aeon is a stylized version of the Stele of Revealing, an Egyptian funerary stele that was central to his experience in receiving the Book of the Law. Crowley's personal magical glyphs, such as the seven-pointed star and the mark of the beast, appear on the Ace of Discs and Prince of Wands. Key terms like thelema, or will, appear on the Ace of Swords blade, or abrahadabra is embroidered on the chariot's canopy. Crowley also drew inspiration from a broad spectrum of writers, thinkers, and scientists. These authors represent the phallic basis of religion, the sociology of magic and mythology, French occultism, logic and philosophy, and modern physics and mathematics. In his essay on the Pack of Thoth, Gerald York noted the card's use of modern scientific images, the Möbius strip, lunar tides. Oh, there we go. I got off here a little bit. Lunar tides. Martian canals. And J.W.N. Sullivan's version of the periodic table, which Crowley looked like a house, but it reminds me of a wire coat hanger. Now, although Crowley specified the overall design of each card, he, quote, left Lady Harris a comparatively free hand in respect of insignificant details. She made the most of this freedom, including imbuing the cards with her artistic and esoteric interests. As Harris informed attendees of her lecture at the Tomorrow Club, I have taken great care to use the primitive four colors on each card allocated by tradition to the sign of the zodiac, planet, and element which govern it. In the Golden Dawn system, each of these is assigned a color. In fact, there isn't just one color scheme, but four, representing the four Kabbalistic worlds of creation. This complicated matters, as illustrated in the letter to Crowley, wherein Harris agonizes over these fine details. So here I'm quoting, you know, I've been looking again at those colors. A horrible feeling affrights me. I see in magic you use the 1 through 10 for the suits. Now we have been using the colors belonging to the ruling planet and zodiacal sign. Is that all right, or do I also combine the colors which can be used such, as in the 2 of cups? I see I could have used purple, soft blue, gray, blue, pearl, gray, white-flecked red, blue, and yellow, as well as the Venus, emerald green, sky blue, early spring green, bright rose, or cerise red pale yellow. And Cancer, amber, maroon, rich bright russet, dark greenish brown. Are we forgetting something? Please let me know before I begin the Three of Cups, as it gives me more scope. I imagine in the Three of Cups, I should be able to use crimson, black, dark brown, gray-flecked pink, and Cancer, amber, maroon, bright russet, dark greenish-brown, and Mercury, yellow, purple, gray, indigo-rayed violet. Have we got a bit muddled? So she was clearly kind of confused trying to like fit things into these parameters, but yet fit in all these different color schemes. Harris also sought to update the artistry of the tarot. As she explained in a lecture to the Sesame Club, the tarot cards that I have seen seem to represent the thought of the period in which they were designed. The 17th and 18th century have got a definite stamp of the Baroque and are decorated with scrolls and curves. Mantegna has done 5 or 6, which I saw at the British Museum. They're classical, restrained, and dignified pictures of goddesses. For earlier and more primitive ones are much simpler, and they state the symbols coarsely but frankly. Some of them are quite gay and childish, but the meaning is clear. I have made an effort in this present pack to embody the current mode of the century. And she's absolutely right. Even the Rider-Waite deck from 1910 by A.E. Waite and Pamela Coleman Smith looks like a Renaissance sphere, albeit with less clothing. Thus, Harris incorporated a variety of modern styles into the cards. For example, the tower resembles Picasso's jarring and disjointed cubism applied to the fall of Mordor. Elsewhere, she draws upon abstract, surrealist, expressionist, symbolist, and Art Deco styles. In addition to painting the cards in a modern style, she also had a more abstract goal. I have tried to introduce among the cards the element of time. In nearly all the designs, the straight lines of the former cards, such as the check patterns, the rays of the sun, the chart of the universe with the stars, are expressed, in her deck, in a curve. I hope to convey the idea of movement. Death in Trumps has to suggest the idea of reincarnation as opposed to putrefaction. He is weaving with his scythe a geometrical web of new forms. One striking detail of the Thoth Tarot is that their objects do not occupy a particular physical location, but instead appear in a kind of abstract geometric space. Doctor Strange would feel right at home in the world of the Magus. And behind the Hanged Man, we have, I'm going to go with Yoga Bat. Harris really goes to town on the pips, which appear to draw inspiration from Kandinsky's geometric abstraction and other non-objective art of her peers. As she explains, each of the ideas embodied in these pictures seems in space, so that you can approach them from many aspects such as alchemy, symbolism, science, geometry, whatever your favorite kickoff is. You will probably find out that the conclusions would bring you out, in the words of Omar Khayyam, at the same door wherein you went. But you will also have sensed the feeling of movement and rhythm proper to the elemental forces, which is implicit in the tarot. Okay, there we go. Another inspiration for this approach is how anthroposophist Rudolf Steiner looked at projective geometry. Projective geometry was a popular branch of Victorian mathematics dealing with the relationship between objects and their mapping or projection onto another surface. For example, a shadow is the projection of a three-dimensional shape onto a two-dimensional surface. It is an outgrowth of perspective art where sight lines are extended and intersect at an idealized horizon. Whereas in conventional geometry, a point is finite and the line is infinitely long, it is the opposite in projective geometry. the point, rather than being finite, is now the vanishing point, the horizon at infinity. Well, any line stretching to that vanishing point is a finite instance of all possible sight lines that could intersect at infinity. I go into great detail about this elsewhere, but briefly, Steiner believed that the interaction between ordinary geometric space and projective geometric space, which he called sun space, is the source of the universe's life force. Anthroposophist George Adams Kaufman championed this teaching, publishing books like Space in the Light of the Creation and Synthetic Geometry in the Light of Spiritual Science, and also teaching at the Rudolf Steiner House on Park Road in London. He was assisted by Olive Witcher, who was his collaborator for 28 years and who continued teaching and publishing on her own after Adams died. According to Witcher, Harris's flat was near Rudolf Steiner House, and she attended projective geometry lectures there around 1937 or 1938. The classes offered by Kaufman and Witcher around this time included geometry and geometrical drawing, geometry and the animal kingdom, practical class in geometric drawing, the lemniscate and its relation to threefold man. Steiner House has no attendance records, but this last one coincides with her tarot work, and its description reads, "Geometry will be treated according to the modern method of synthetic geometry, which opens out the way to an understanding of the more cosmic forces in nature in harmony with spiritual science. No previous knowledge is presumed. Exercises in geometrical drawing will stimulate the imagination of form in movement." Witcher also taught Harris privately at her studio. In return, Harris advised Kaufman and Witcher on combining soft pastels and hard pencils in coloring their geometric and plant pictures. Geometric shapes from Adams and Witcher's writings appear in many cards of the Thoth Tarot. Here we see how the Hierophant follows the shape of this projective object. Other examples include the Six of Swords, the Priestess, Queen of Swords, and the Star. These geometric shapes were just one tool in her arsenal, but they were a natural fit for Harris's modernist style. In a letter to Crowley, she revealed how she approached the liminal for inspiration, and I absolutely love how its essence is artistic and not mystical, and yet it is completely mystical. If you remember only one quote from this talk, I hope this is it. Where is she? There we go. "My gods have no human forms, only curves, angles, and light, movement, color, sound. And when I draw, the moment I fall on one that is familiar to me, I bend the knee and shout, holy, holy, holy. They have no moral sense. They are neither good nor bad, only inevitable and therefore right in the true sense. And I believe they are gods. I have often wanted to tell you that when I am lucky enough to push open the door of vision, there are no earths, no stars, no moons, no holy angels or holy devils, no words. Only movement, light, and form, and inexpressible gaiety." I just love that. Around September 1939, Harris began living at Rolling Stone Orchard, Chipping Camden, Gloucestershire. This coincided with two significant events in London: blackout regulations introduced on September 1st, and 2 days later, Britain's declaration of war against Germany. World War II had begun. This necessitated that most of the tarot work be done via mail, with only occasional face-to-face meetings. As Harris described her new living accommodations to Crowley, "I am living here without any servant and in the top of a garage. No drains, no hot water, no electric light, only gas, but quite tolerable to me, as I am able to work without undue interruption. I have no telephone and no wireless and no friends here. I have to walk up a henloft ladder to sleep in my studio. All the furniture I have is what you kindly spared from Richmond and one carpet belonging to Nick, her son." Crowley would send Harris rough sketches and notes about cards for her to work from. Sometimes the process involved arguments and negotiations, and for this quote, interpret this as sarcasm on. You start with, this is a simple card. Then you say you want a sun, rayed and nebulic, 2, a rose, 3, a spectrum, 4, 12 signs of the zodiac in pictures, 5, twins, 6, green hill, 7, wall, 8, python scales, 9, druid stones. I don't think it's enough for a large space like 16.5 by 10.5. Because Crowley was a perfectionist, a number of cards needed to be redone once or twice, or as in the case of the Magus, 7 times. Much mischief was caused when Urania Verlag included 2 of these rejected magi in their 1986 printing of the Thoth Tarot, with some cartomancers coming up with unique meanings for these cards and including them all in their readings. The simple fact of the matter is that the tarot consists of 78 cards, while the printing sheet has 80 spots. My deck from Samuel Weiser filled those 2 extra spots with these cards. Urania Verlag simply included 2 rejected drafts as a fun bonus. Neither Crowley, Harris, nor Urania Verlag ever intended for these cards to actually be used. Indeed, Crowley was furious when Harris used 1 of the rejected magi on a gallery book. So it's safe to say that old Crow would have roundly condemned this state of affairs. Harris herself was just as much a perfectionist as Crowley, however, writing to Crowley, "Those princes worry me. I feel an access of shame when I show them to anyone. Shows they aren't good enough, I fear. They seem past century." She replaced them with something superior and more modern. So in all, 17 cards are known to have rejected versions, 7 out of 22 major arcana cards, 6 out of 16 court cards, and 4 out of 4 aces. Now, as a case study, the exchange between Crowley and Harris about adjustment is particularly revealing of their working dynamic. Crowley submitted a sketch, and Harris replied with this. Crowley's response is both philosophical and artistic. "I do feel strongly that the plumes of Maat are too insignificant, and the dove and the raven look simply stuck on. Nor do I think that the tessellated pavement is quite right. The general criticism is that the card is a little too cold. Libra is the sign of autumn, season of the mists and mellow fruitfulness, cold-bosomed friend of the maturing sun. In your card, you've got the idea of balance static, whereas it ought to be dynamic. Nature is not the grocer weighing out a pound of sugar. It is the compensation of complicated rhythms. I should like you to feel that every adjustment was a grand passion. Compensation should be a festival, not a clerk smugly pleased that his accounts are correct." It seems to me that this doctrine is very important as a commentary on the text, "Existence is pure joy." And I feel sure that the connection of Venus and Saturn with the sign is significant in this respect. In a follow-up letter, which does not appear to survive, Crowley apparently requested that Harris redo the card in the style of Beardsley. Harris responded with quite a big piece of her mind, beginning with, come on, "Know what you won't do shall be the whole of my law. I can bear many things, chilblains included, but I will not draw a lady like Aubrey Beardsley. What must you have eaten or drunken? I can't imagine to visualize such a horrifying object. Old Edwardian indecency drawn by a lineal introvert, I call him, and none of his filigree pattern scabbing will make me endure to look at his lifeless ladies, which make me vomit. And how period he is, the product of a small collection of intentionally vicious sillies. This master for me to imitate, and a work you assure me will be lauded down through the ages. It makes me doubt the whole contraption. I feel inclined to chuck the whole lot in the snow." Wow. Yay, Frida. I love that quote, too. I think that's my second favorite quote. She stopped work on this card for 7 months, but eventually relented. As Harris reported of her new attempt, "Adjustment is being queer with me. She has, after all, insisted on being Beardsley. Also, Harlequin comes in and out of it, so I must have to submit. Also, she won't sit down, but stands on her toes, just balanced. The design result is good." Thus, in the Book of Thoth, Crowley writes of adjustment, not only, therefore, because Libra is a sign of Venus, but because she is the partner of the fool, is the goddess represented as dancing with the suggestion of Harlequin. Even more interesting than this is Harris's commentary on this card in a lecture she gave to the Sesame Club. "I would like to speak of a tradition that the Commedia dell'arte originated in the tarot. The suggestion is that the Harlequin is to be found in the trump called Justice, its name now changed to Adjustment, and is the French meaning of la justice. This justice holds a sword and stands tiptoe. The balances are suspended from her headdress and contain the bubble of illusion or Maya. Now, in the Commedia dell'arte, the Harlequin holds a wand, it may have been a sword, and adjusts, judges, or resolves every incident in the comedy. His diamond check costume may have been taken from the four points of the diamond on the tarot card and would typify, I suppose, the four elements which are in his command. The Book of Thoth does not represent the Commedia, yet its symbolism informed Harris's depiction. The Commedia dell'arte also informs how Harris sees her favorite card, the Fool. Crowley rejected her initial design, observing, abhorring its pop culture reference to Harpo Marx. While she designed a new card that Crowley approved, it drew from many of the same ideas of her original design. In a lecture to the Tomorrow Club, Harris explains the symbolism of this figure who has passed through all literature and religions. She hits the high points from the Book of Thoth, Air, the Green Man of Spring, Parsifal, Bacchus, etc. But she adds her own interpretations. These include The Idiot of Dostoevsky, Watteau's Lovely White Pierrot, Till Eulenspiegel, and both Harlequin and Clown in the Commedia dell'arte, hence their rainbow-colored costumes. Perhaps we find him reincarnated in the movies, in the motley dress and idiotic laughter of Harpo, or shall I call him Harparchis? Marx. Oh, I'm sorry, Frida, I meant this. A common theme she expresses concerning the pips is that each suit represents a progression from its idealized form to its most material and debased manifestation. Thus, when lecturing to the Sesame Club, she says of the swords, "We can see in the ace the sword used to symbolize the highest form of scintillating intellect. Number two, peace, still shows that the intellect, coupled with beauty, is a controlled force. But after that, we are clearly shown by the old tradition a picture of destructive intelligence." She reiterates this point with the discs. Here again, quoting, "We can get the best aspect in the ace of discs, and from that, right up through the numbers, we can see a deterioration by constant elaboration of material until we reach the 10, in which we see the disc becomes a massive, stodgy pile of coins." When a group of children attended one of her gallery shows, she found herself improvising a delightful explanation for one of the cards. "Then they asked me, what is the meaning of lust? That's a knockout blow for a poor adult. So, somewhat timorously, I said, well, you must understand the feeling of it. Now, how do you feel if you see nice chocolates and there you get them, and how good they are? That is a picture of how you see the chocolates." Well done. Perhaps the best commentary by Harris with which to end our talk today is her poem Capricorn, the Goat, from her poetry collection Bump into Heaven. She's almost certainly referring here to the card The Devil, which Crowley included, over her objections, in his Christmas 1941 broadsheet, Liber Oz. "The Goat, the Scapegoat, hail Capricorn, his master Azazel, standard bearer, in the rebel hosts, He is the jinn of the desert, son of fire. After the fall, his name was changed to Eblis. Despair, despair, suffering and conflict. He chose the left-hand path. And fell from heaven, Lucifer the accursed, Judas the damned, the unredeemed, the dreaded Lingam. He chose the left-hand path. But among his peers within the zodiac, even to him, another choice is free, withdrawn from moon attainment. He can turn through the straight gateway of initiation, and he shall be transformed. Thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of the conference.
This is Marco Bazzi.
Hi, Marco.
Hi. In the paintings that were found in Sicily some years ago and that were shown in Paris in 2008, there was a number of them that clearly were based on the Tarot. There was a sun, the moon, the Hierophant. So I think these were earlier attempts by Crowley to sort of visualize and perhaps also recreate a tarot deck, or at least this is how I interpret these images that were made during the Cefalù period. So I was wondering whether Crowley ever mentions these earlier attempts in the correspondence with Frieda Harris, and whether you tried to make a comparison between these images and, well, the versions of the tarot that was made out of this collaboration between Frieda Harris and Crowley. Especially with the Hierophant, I think it's clear that Crowley was already there at that moment. And it would be interesting to, well, to reflect a little bit about why he didn't continue. Basically, there are only three cards that he made. There were certainly practical reasons, because he was expelled from Sicily, and yeah, materially things were difficult for him afterwards. And also perhaps he was not satisfied, and he really needed the hand of an artist to help him out with this enterprise. So I just wanted to hear your thoughts about this.
Sure, sure. And for those of you who aren't familiar with these other art, Marco mentioned there were three cards that appeared to be tarot cards. You mentioned the Hierophant, the other two are the moon, and a self-portrait that appears to be a study for the sun card. And in some talks I've given about the Thoth Tarot, I have actually presented those in that context. And I haven't seen Crowley mention those paintings in any of his correspondence with Harris. So I kind of thought that it didn't kind of fit with the flow of the discussion here, particularly within the limits of time. But I agree. I think, you know, Crowley, I mean, we see that throughout his career, he's given a lot of thought to the tarot and how it fits into his writings, and even trying to rethink some of the symbolism. So when you know, with the story that we get of Harris suggesting that he rethink the tarot, I do think that Crowley was already well on his way, as those paintings show. You know, one thing that just kind of occurs to me, and I can't say this definitively, but you know, when you mentioned those paintings were kind of, you know, in Cefalù and only recently discovered, you know, makes me think Crowley may not have had access to them either to, you know, mention or show to Frieda as inspiration. So that's also another possibility of why they may not have figured more prominently in the later discussions between Crowley and Harris.
They were clearly left behind. When he left Sicily, they stayed there. So.
Yeah. Fortunately, they were rediscovered.
I didn't know about the Cefalù paintings, but there's a couple of things. One is Crowley actually says that until Frieda Harris did her stuff, he she'd actually managed to realise his vision and that she'd brought it forward for him. And I think an awful lot of Crowley's work involved a female and a male partner, didn't it? And to use the cards and the process of creating the cards was another one of these magical partnerships to work together. Just
So I'm sorry, was there a question there, or were you just...
Okay.
but yeah, I mean, I agree. It's amazing how well their collaboration worked. I mean, it really is something where the sum is certainly greater than, or the whole is greater than the sum of its parts.
I think I'll take chair's privilege and ask a question. You mentioned the myriad different sources of inspiration.
You want the microphone?
Yeah. You mentioned the different sources of inspiration for the art in this deck. Is this a more syncretic deck than previous ones?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, that's one of the things that Frida brought to it. I mean, more in terms of the artistic style. I think as you go through it, there really is this variety of styles that she uses, and she was very consciously trying to paint all of the cards in a 20th century style, and you kind of hear that in a couple of the letters that I quoted, where she worries about like the princes sounding looking too last century, mm-hmm. that she doesn't like Beardsley. He looks very dated, even by 1930. You know, she says it's passé already. So she was really trying to be very modern mm-hmm. in all of her designs. I think that was really in the forefront of her mind as she painted all of these. Let me locate that. It's from a letter that she wrote to Crowley, basically kind of a confessional. Yeah, it's a letter from Frida Harris to Aleister Crowley, dated December 22nd, 1939. And it's part of the correspondence that is in the York collection at the Warburg Institute in the University of London. You're welcome. I tried to put the citations up on the slides as I went, but you know, some of them are probably not as visible. Want to hear the quote again?
Yeah.
All right. I'm happy to, because I just love that quote. My gods have no human forms, only curves, angles, and light, movement, color, sound. And when I draw, the moment I fall on one that is familiar to me, I bend the knee and shout, holy, holy, holy. They have no moral sense. They are neither good nor bad, only inevitable, and therefore right in the true sense. And I believe they are gods. I have often wanted to tell you that when I am lucky enough to push open the door of vision, there are no earths, no stars, no moons, no holy angels or holy devils, no words. Only movement, light, and form, and inexpressible gaiety.
Wow.
Yeah. Love that quote. Yay, Frida. The second favorite quote? Oh, that's where the do know what you won't do shall be the whole of my law. Yeah. Okay, and that's a letter of Frida Harris to Aleister Crowley, and the date on that is December 29th, 1939. That's also from the York collection. Welcome.
It seems there are no more questions, so I'll
Wonderful.
Just thank you again, Richard, for a fantastic talk.
A pleasure.